Today we continue Kitab al-Tawheed alladhi huwa haqqu Allahi ala al-Abid, the book of Tawheed, monotheism, which is the right of Allah over His creation. And we read chapter number 1 and chapter number 2, and we saw how those two chapters, they were about establishing the obligation of Tawheed and the importance of Tawheed, and that Tawheed is the message of all the prophets of Allah, and that Tawheed is the first obligation on the creatures, and then the opposite of that, a shirk, associating partners with Allah, is the greatest sin. It is the greatest sin. And we saw how the one who comes on the day of judgment with all the sins he committed, as long as he never committed the sin of shirk, meaning he died upon Tawheed, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive him all of those sins. Allah will forgive him all of those sins. Now moving on to the third chapter, he says, the Sheikh, chapter number 3, whoever purifies his Tawheed, دخل الجنة بغير حساب. Whoever purifies his Tawheed, دخل الجنة بغير حساب. Whoever purifies his Tawheed will enter paradise with no reckoning, with no accounting. He brings the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Inna Ibrahima kana ummatan qanitan lillahi hanifan wa lam yakun minal mushrikeen shakiran li an'umih ijtabahu wa hadahu ila siratin mustaqim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, surely Ibrahim was indeed an ummah, What translation do you have? Model? He was an ummah, and he was qanitan lillahi, devoutly obedient to Allah. Hanifan, he was someone who always leaned and was always close to Tawheed, running away from shirk. That is the meaning of Hanif. The meaning of Hanif, which is a word which comes a lot in the Quran. What is the meaning of Hanif? Someone who always goes to Tawheed and runs away from shirk. That is the meaning of Hanif. That is the meaning of Hanif. وَلَمْ يَكُ مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ, and he, Ibrahim, was not from those people who committed shirk. Now, if you noticed, I said, إِنَّ إِبْرَهِيمَ, surely Ibrahim was an ummah. The word ummah in the Quran, it comes with four meanings. The word ummah in the Quran, it comes with four meanings. The first meaning of the word ummah is what? A nation. Ahsant. A nation. The first meaning of the word ummah is a nation. As you know, when we say ummah, we mean the nation of Islam. A group of people. That's what ummah means. The second meaning of the word ummah is what? Huh? A time or a place? What is the proof for that? Huh? وقال الذي نجا منهما وادكر بعد امه. In the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, he met the two people who saw their dreams in the jail, in the prison. One of them explained his dream, the other one explained his dream. One of them was to die, the other one was to survive and to be close to the king. After he goes out, he's with the king sees a dream. The king says, who can explain this dream? Nobody can explain. Then he remembered, وَدَّكَرَ بَعْدَ أُمَّةٍ, and he remembered after an ummah. Ummah meaning time. He remembered after time. So number one, ummah means nation. Number two, it means time. Number three is the one which you see here. Ummah meaning a role model. A role model, someone to be followed. Someone to be followed. Number four, what is the fourth meaning of the word ummah? Ummah is a religion. A religion. Or a way of doing things. The Quraysh of Makkah and the other kuffar, when they were told, come to Islam, what did they used to say? Inna wajadna aba'ana ala ummatin wa inna ala atharihim la muqtadun. We found our fathers on an ummah, on a particular way, on a religion, and we are going to follow their way. This is the four meanings of the word ummah as it comes in the Quran. So here, though, it means he was the role model. Ibrahim alayhi salam was a role model, and he was qanitan lillahi, firmly, devoutly obedient to Allah. The second verse the Shaykh brings, he says, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also said, وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِرَبِّهِمْ لَا يُشْرِكُونَ. And they are the people who do not commit shirk, they do not ascribe partners with their Lord. What is for them? What is the next verse after that? وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِرَبِّهِمْ لَا يُشْرِكُونَ. And then, this verse is with surah Mu'minun, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking about those who are going to Jannah, right or wrong? Where is this verse, beginning or end of surah Mu'minun? In the middle. وَالَّذِينَ هُمْ بِرَبِّهِمْ لَا يُشْرِكُونَ. What comes next? وَالَّذِينَ يُتُونَ مَا أَتَوْا. The matter is easy, you can just open your Quran and check here. وَالَّذِينَ يُتُونَ مَا أَتَوْا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ وَجِلَةٌ أَنَّهُمْ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ رَاجِعُونَ. أُولَٰئِكَ يُسَارِعُونَ فِي الْخَيْرَاتِ وَهُمْ لَهَا سَابِقُونَ. This is one of the characteristics of those who have succeeded. And then he brings the hadith from Hussein ibn Abdul Rahman. And the hadith is the main text in this chapter, showing that whoever purifies his tawheed from shirk, he will enter Jannah without any accounting. Hussein ibn Abdul Rahman qala kuntu 'inda Sa'id ibn Jubair. I was with Sa'id ibn Jubair. Sa'id ibn Jubair was one of the greatest scholars of Islam. He is from the Tabi'un, the second generation of Muslims. Those who saw the Sahaba, the companions, but they never saw the Prophet. Sa'id ibn Jubair When we mention the Tabi'un, the second generation of Muslims, he is in the top five. He's in the top five. Sa'id ibn Jubair. So Hussein ibn Abdurrahman, he says, I was with Sa'id ibn Jubair. فَقَالَ, and he said to me, he said, أَيُّكُمْ رَأَى الْكَوْكَبَ الَّذِي انْقَضَّ الْبَارِحَةَ. Who amongst you saw that shooting star, the meteor, which went through the sky last night? Who amongst you saw that shooting star last night? فَقُلْتُ أَنَا. So Hussein says, I saw it. ثُمَّ قُلْتُ, and then I said though, أَمَا إِنِّي لَمْ أَكُنْ فِي صَلَاةٍ وَلَكِنْ لُدِغْتُ. I saw it, but I was not standing up praying, but I was stung. And he said that so that people don't get a wrong impression of him, that he is someone who's standing all night praying. He's saying that so that people don't think he's bragging. I was up all night because I was praying. And that's how the believer is. The believer runs away from praising himself. He says, I was not praying, ولكن لدغت, I was stung. I was stung, meaning by a poisonous animal. لدغت means I was stung by a poisonous animal, which is generally imma, spider, scorpion, or snake. قال, so Sa'id said to him, فما صنعت, what did you do? You're stung, what did you do? قلت ارتقيت. He said, Hussein, ارتقيت, I performed ruqya on myself. Ruqya is the act of seeking a cure by reciting verses of the Quran and some adhkar, remembrances which come from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and du'as, supplications. That is called ruqya, seeking treatment by the Quran and what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us to say. فقال, so Sa'id said to him, فما حملك على ذلك, what made you do that? And he replied, قلت حديث حدثناه الشعبي. He said, it's a hadith which was reported to us by a Sha'bi. A Sha'bi is one of the great imams of hadith from Iraq, Imam al-Sha'bi. قلت, he says, حديث حدثناه الشعبي. So Sa'id said, ما حدثكم, what did he narrate to you? What is this hadith he told you? قال, so Hussein, he said, قلت حدثنا عن بريدة بن الحسيب. الشعبي narrated to us from بريدة بن الحسيب, أنه قال, that he said, لا رقية إلا من عين أو حمة. There is no رقية except from عين, evil eye, أو حمة, or fever. When you get stung, you get a fever. So Sa'id, when he had this, he said, قال وقد أحسن من انتهى إلى ما سمع. He has done well, the one who stops at what he heard. He has done well, the one who knows his level of knowledge. This is what I know, this is what I'm just informing. This is another great important thing we have to learn. People should know their levels. We discussed this today in Surah Al-Imran, tafsir of Surah Al-Imran. Allah says, وَالرَّاسِخُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ. There are people who are rasikhun, firmly grounded, mountains of knowledge. And there are others who are not like that. When you know your status, that is the best thing you can do. He said then, وَلَكِنْ حَدَّثَنَا Ibn Abbas, but us, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he narrated to us, and Sa'id ibn Jubair, he took a lot of knowledge from Ibn Abbas. He says, but Ibn Abbas narrated to us عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, أنه قال, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, عُرِضَتْ عَلَيَّ الْأُمَمُ, the nations. أُمَّةٌ is one, أُمَم is the plural of it. Alright? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I was shown the nations, all of them. فَرَأَيْتُ النَّبِيَّ, each nation had its prophet who was leading it. And I saw a prophet, ومعه الرهط, and he had a group of people. A group of people. والنبي, and I saw another prophet, ومعه الرجل والرجلان. And I saw another prophet, he only had one person or two people who followed him. Subhanallah. والنبي, and I saw another prophet, وليس معه أحد, he has no followers. Which is an extremely important lesson for us to learn. The truth is not judged by numbers. The truth is not judged by numbers. These are prophets of Allah. Allah sent them to their people. Their people refused to believe. They did their job. And a prophet who comes with a group of people. Rahd. Rahd is up to, they say some of them, they say up to 20. That's all. That's Rahd. A prophet was one or two people who followed him. And a prophet was no followers. Was their message right or wrong? We discussed yesterday. The message is the same from Allah. Allah chose the best humans to be prophets. They did the job perfectly. The problem is people didn't follow. That is their problem. The truth is not judged by people. Not just someone comes, oh, you don't listen to Sheikh so-and-so? He's very good. Everybody listens to him. So you feel, oh, I have to listen to him also. No, you don't. That is not how the truth is judged. That is not how the truth is judged. Do you listen to Sheikh so-and-so? He speaks with the Quran and the Sunnah. And he teaches people the things the Prophet ﷺ used to teach. Then you listen. Not by numbers. Not by Facebook followers. No. This is very important. Very important. Then he says the Prophet ﷺ, إِذْ رُفِعَ لِي سَوَادٌ عَظِيمٌ. And then I saw a huge crowd. فَظَنَنْتُ أَنَّهُمْ أُمَّتِي. And I thought, they are my ummah. I thought these are my followers. فَقِيلَ لِي. But it was said to me, هَذَا مُوسَى وَقَوْمُهُ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَاةُ السَّلَامُ. This is Musa عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ, Moses and his people. فَنَظَرْتُ. And then I looked around. فَإِذَا سَوَادٌ عَظِيمٌ. And I saw another huge crowd. فَقِيلَ لِي. It was said to me, هَذِهِ أُمَّتُكَ. This is your ummah. Those who will follow you. وَمَعَهُمْ سَبْعُونَ أَلْفًا. And from them, there is 70,000 of them. يَدُخُلُونَ الْجَنَّةَ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ وَلَا عَذَابٍ. They will enter into Jannah, paradise, with no accounting, no judgment, no reckoning, and no punishment. Meaning, direct to Jannah. From them, your ummah, there are 70,000 who will enter paradise, Jannah, with no accounting on the day of judgment, and no punishment. What does that mean? Remember we said, the one who dies upon Tawheed, even if he committed sins, he might be punished to be purified from his sins, but at the end he will go to Jannah, to paradise. Because he died upon Tawheed, he never did shirk. There are part of the Muslim Ummah who will be like that. And there are others who will be judged and they'll go to Jannah. And there's this special group who will go to Jannah with no judgment and no accounting, no punishment. ثم نهض فدخل منزله. When the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said this, he stood up and he went into his house. فخاض الناس في أولئك. So the people who were listening to that, they started to debate and talk and argue. Who are these people? They must be really special. فقال بعضهم, some of them said, فلعلهم الذين سحبوا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, أي سحبة الأولى السابقون. Some of them said, maybe these are the people who believed in him the first time, the first days, and they are his companions from his first days. وقال بعضهم, and some of them said, فلعلهم الذين ولدوا في الإسلام فلم يشركوا بالله شيئا. Maybe they are those who are born into Islam, so they never committed shirk, even one day. Because many of the Sahaba, they entered into Islam, right? They reverted into Islam. So they said, maybe it's those who are lucky enough, if you want to use the word lucky, I like the word fortunate, because we don't believe in luck, do we? That's a chapter in Kitab al-Tawheed, by the way. Maybe that those who are born into Islam, so they never committed shirk. وَذَكَرُوا أَشْيَاءَ, and they mention other things. Maybe they're this, maybe they're that, maybe they're this. فَخَرَجَ عَلَيْهِمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ, so the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he came out to them. فَأَخْبَرُوهُ, and they informed him about what they are arguing. فَقَالَ, so the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, mentioning who are these 70,000 special people. هُمُ الَّذِينَ, they are those. لَا يَسْتَرْقُونَ, لَا يَسْتَرْقُونَ, they do not ask for ruqya. وَلَا يَكْتَأُونَ, and they do not perform what they call cauterization in English, or branding. وَلَا يَتَطَيَّرُونَ, and they do not believe in evil omens or superstitions. وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ, and they are people who fully depend and rely on their Lord. They have tawakkul. فَقَامَ عُكَّاش ibn Mihsan, so the Sahabi عُكَّاش ibn Mihsan stood up right away. فَقَالَ, he said, أُدْعُوا اللَّهَ أَنْ يَجْعَلَنِي مِنْهُمْ, he said, O Messenger of Allah, ask Allah to make me one of these people. فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, أَنْتَ مِنْهُمْ, he said, you are from them. فَقَامَ رَجْلٌ آخر, another Sahabi stood up, he said, يَا رَسُولَ, أُدْعُوا اللَّهَ لِيَنْ أَكُونَ مِنْهُمْ, ask Allah that I be from them. And he said, سَبَقَكَ عُكَّاشَ, عُكَّاشَ, he beat you to that. Allahu Akbar. السَّابِقُونَ لِلْخَيْرَاتِ, those are the ones, they rush to do good deeds. They rush to do good deeds. And this tells you the fadl, the excellence of the Sahaba called Ukasha. He is one of those, we know he's guaranteed paradise. But our point though, now coming back to what we are learning here. Who are these people who will enter Jannah with no accounting and no punishment? لا يسترقون, they do not seek ruqyah. They do not ask for ruqya from other people. What is ruqya? We just said, treatment by the Quran and the ahadith and the adhkar, the remembrances and the du'as which come from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You read on yourself and Allah cures you. Allah says the Quran is a cure. That is called ruqya. So they are people who don't seek ruqya from others. The best ruqya is you doing it on yourself. Allah says the Quran is a cure. وَنُنَزِّلُ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ مَا هُوَ شِفَاءٌ. We revealed in the Quran what is a cure. If you believe in Allah, Allah has told you this book is a cure. It's you having trust in Allah and saying, Ya Rab, I'm going to read on myself. I want you, inshallah, to cure me. There are people who do not ask for ruqya. Does it mean asking for ruqya is haram? No, it's not haram. But you disqualify yourself from being from these 70,000 people. It's not haram to ask from someone else to do ruqya on you. And it might become haram if you believe he is the one who's the source of cure. In fact, it might become shirk. Some people have this idea. Oh, Sheikh so-and-so, only him. La a'udhu billah, why? The cure is the Quran, asking Allah sincerely. Alright? وَلَا يَكْتَوُونَ, they do not perform kay. Kay is the treatment by fire. It's called branding or cauterization in English. Where you take a piece of metal, an iron rod or so, you pour it in fire until it becomes red hot, and you put on the place of pain. You've seen that. It's a traditional way of cure. In English, it's called branding or cauterization. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he told us it is a cure, but he said, I don't like it. You should make it the last result. If there's no cure for your disease, then try that. And it works. It works. But there are people, is it haram to perform kay? It's not haram, but if you perform it, you take yourself out from the 70,000. وَلَا يَتَطَيَّرُونَ, and they do not believe in omens, or you call omens In common language, you call them superstitions. There's a whole chapter on that here also in Kitab al-Tawheed. But just to give you examples. Huh? The building you live in, does it have floor number 13? Huh? The building you live in, does it have floor number 13? Say, no, 13 is unlucky number. This is a tayra. This is part of these omens we're talking about. You understand? Or if you walk at night and a black cat walks in front of you, then bad things will happen to you. This is from the Torah. Or those who say if you come out in the morning and the first person you see is someone who's handicapped, then that is a bad day for you. These are all omens like that. Or you don't get married on Wednesday. Who told you? You don't get married in Muharram. These are all omens which have no part of Islam, superstitions. The people who will enter Jannah with no accounting and no punishment, they don't believe in these superstitions. And the base common factor for all of these traits is what? وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. They are people of tawakkul. So they don't ask other people ruqya. They depend on Allah themselves. So they ask, they read for themselves. They are people of tawakkul. They depend on Allah and they rely on Allah, they themselves. They don't have to ask people. وَلَا يَكْتَوُونَ. They do not perform cauterization. They depend on Allah and they take other forms of medicine. وَلَا يَتَطَيَّرُونَ. They don't believe in these omens. They believe that Allah is going to take care of me. Whether it is a black cat or a blue cat who passes, doesn't matter. There are people whose hearts are attached to Allah. And this is, as Sheikh Abdul Rahman al-Sa'di, he said in the coming parts of this book, At-tawakkul, depending on Allah and relying on Allah, that is the spirit of Tawheed. That is the spirit of Tawheed. So these are the people who will enter Jannah with no accounting and no punishment. Now in one of the narrations in Sahih Muslim, it says, الَّذِينَ لَا يَرْقُونَ. They don't perform ruqya. This is a mistake from one of the narrators. It is لَا يَسْتَرْقُونَ. They don't seek ruqya. And maybe that's the translation you guys have. Does it say, these people, those people are those who don't treat themselves with ruqya? That's what it says, right? That is wrong. Doing ruqya is something which is good. La yastarqun, they don't seek ruqya, they don't ask other people. There's nothing wrong with you doing ruqya on yourself. This is a mistake in one of the narrators. And the translators, whoever translated just like that. And this hadith, of course, is agreed upon by Bukhari and Muslim. So this tells you, Khan, again, the excellence of Tawheed. The excellence of Tawheed, purifying Tawheed. And you ask Allah to make us from those who will be of these people, the 70,000 who will go to Jannah. There's another narration, though, reported by Imam Shaykh al-Albani, brings it in Silsilat al-Sahihah in his book. He said, فَاسْتَزَّدْتُ رَبِّي. So I asked for more from my Lord. Because imagine 70,000. Right now, how many Muslims are there? Right now. 1 billion. If you take away the others who are not Muslim, you know, Qadianis and this and that. And let's say 1 billion. 70,000 from 1 billion. What percentage is that? Is it even 1%? It's not even 1%. That is, those are the Muslims of today, now, 2016, 1437. How many Muslims have passed since the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Trillions, trillions and trillions, right? So from the whole ummah, only 70,000? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, so I asked my Lord for more. فَقَالَ لِي يَرْحَمْكَ اللَّهِ. And Allah said to me, لِكُلِّ مِنْهُمْ سَبْعِينَ أَلْفٍ. From each of these 70,000 will be another 70,000. From each of them will be another 70,000. Yani, multiply 70,000 by 70,000. Well, how much is it? 4.9 million or billion? 4.9 billion. Say Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. Now our chances are open. And if it was 70,000 only, I think that's only the Sahaba. Who can beat the Sahaba? Right? Radiallahu anhu. Who can beat them? Nobody can beat them. Look at Ukasha. Right away the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this, he stood up. Oh, Messenger of Allah, ask Allah to make me one of those. Subhanallah, ikhwan. That's how we are supposed to be. Rushing to do good. So 4.9 billion. You have your chances, I have my chances. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also described them. He said, they are the first group which enter Jannah, and their faces are like the full moon. How beautiful they will be. We ask Allah to make us from these people and our children and our parents. The next chapter, is the chapter Al-Khawfu Min Ash-Shirk, the fear of shirk. Fear of shirk. The fear of shirk. Like we discussed, we have to understand Tawheed so we can practice it. And we have to understand shirk so we can stay away from it. So we can stay away from it. This chapter, he shows us the danger of shirk, how we should fear shirk. He says, قال الله تعالى, Allah the Almighty, he says, إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. This is in Surah An-Nisa, chapter number 4. And the same words, they come twice in the Quran in the same chapter. 48 and 116 of Surah An-Nisa. And just the ending is different. In 48, Allah says, Inna Allah, surely Allah, La yaghfiru, He shall never forgive. And yushraka bihi, that someone commits shirk, associating partners with Him, that sin is never forgiven. وَيَغْفِرُ, but He forgives, مَا دُونَ ذَلِكْ, whatever is lesser than shirk. Any other sin which is not shirk, Allah forgives all of that, لِمَنْ يَشَى, to those He wants. And then He says what, the ending? وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ عبد الفتاح وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ فَقَدْ افْتَرَى إِثْمًا عَظِيمًا. And so whoever commits shirk, associating partners with Allah, He has formulated and fabricated a great evil thing. In the verse of 116, same words. Surely Allah does not forgive that you should set up partners with Him committing shirk. But He forgives all other sins less than that. How does that not end? وَمَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ, and whoever commits shirk, associating partners with Allah, فَقَدْ ضَلَّ, He has gone astray a great way. He's gone astray. So this is the danger of shirk. If you die upon shirk, of course Allah forgives all sins, including shirk, in this world. In this world, Allah forgives everything. That is why someone was a mushrik yesterday, today he took his shahada, he's a Muslim, right? Allah forgives you. And that is the meaning of the verse in Surah Az-Zumar. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَى أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَتُ مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Say to my slaves who have committed so many sins, never give up hope in the mercy of Allah. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Allah, He forgives all sins in this world. In this world, Allah forgives all sins. But in the next life, Allah can forgive whoever He wants, everything except shirk. Except shirk. That tells us the importance of learning Tawheed, so that we'll have those chances that we know even if I die, I had some sins, but alhamdulillah, I never committed shirk. You'll have hope. And you know for sure one day I'll be going to Jannah. But dying upon shirk, as the verse will come, it will say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, I want you to tell me, what surah is this? When Allah says, إِنَّهُ مَنْ يُشْرِكْ بِاللَّهِ فَقَدْ حَرَّمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَأْوَاهُ النَّارِ. Surely, those who commit shirk and they die upon shirk, Allah has made Jannah, paradise, haram, forbidden for them. Surah Al-Ma'idah, Ahsant. Surely, those who die upon shirk, Allah has made Jannah, paradise, haram for them. They shall never go in there. And their ending, their abode, is the hellfire. The importance of dying about Tawheed. And the hadith we read yesterday, the hadith Qudsi in Sunan al-Tirmidhi, Allah says, Ya Ibadi, O my slave, لو أتيتني بقراب الأرض خطايا, if you come to me on the day of judgment, and you have an earth full of sins, you have so many sins which fill the whole earth, ثُمَّ لَمْ تُشْرِكْ بِشَيْءَ, but you never committed shirk. You did all other sins except shirk. And we say this again, shirk with all its different branches. That is why we're studying this book. Shirk is not just going to church. No. There's things which are shirk people are doing every day, Muslims. Shirk of beliefs, shirk of words, some words you say they're shirk. Shirk of actions. Whoever comes, he did all of the sins except he never committed shirk. Allah will forgive him all of those sins. The importance of learning Tawheed so we can be people of Tawheed. And the importance of staying away from shirk so we can be saved. And that tells you that is the greatest gift you can give your child. Your children, my children, the greatest gift we can give them is to teach them Tawheed. So they can stay away from shirk, so we know. No matter how they will be, inshallah, one day we'll meet in Jannah. That is the greatest thing you can give your children. And then he brings another ayah, and this is the statement of Allah on what Ibrahim alayhi salam he said. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he made a lot of du'as. And those du'as, every Muslim has to memorize them. But part of those du'as, can you tell me the beginning of that verse? Huh? وَجِنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَّ نَعْبُدَ الْأَسْلَامِ. Ibrahim alayhi salam, he makes du'a. He's asking Allah, وَجِنُبْنِي, and save me, put me far away. وَبَنِيَّ, and my children. And na'bud al-asnam, that we should worship idols. If Ibrahim alayhi salam, who we just read, Allah said to us that he is an ummah, role model, we have to follow him. If we have to follow him, we have to follow him in everything. This is one of the ways we have to follow Ibrahim alayhi salam. We have to make dua to Allah to save us from shirk. You have to. وَجُنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَّ نَعْبُدَ الْأَسْنَامِ. If you go to Surah Ibrahim, this is Surah Ibrahim, chapter number 14. رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدْ آمِنًا. Oh Allah, make this land to be peaceful. Remember when Ibrahim went to Mecca. And then what? رَبِّ جَعَلْ هَذَا بَلَدًا آمِنًا وَجُنُبْنِي وَبَنِيَّ نَعْبُدَ الْأَسْنَامِ, and save me and my children from worshipping idols. And then he said what? ماذا بعد؟ رب إنهن ضللن كثيرا من الناس. They have led astray. So many people are worshipping idols. An idol does not have to be an idol. Today people worship fellow human beings. And the trick of shaitan proved so true. They actually call them idols. Right or wrong? Who's your idol? Michael Jordan. Who's your idol? Beyonce. Who's your idol? Martin Luther King. Who's your idol? LeBron James. Who's your idol? Diego Maradona. Who's right or wrong? Who's your idol? Sachin Tendulkar. We call them idols, right or wrong? And we worship them. You worship them. The people worship them. You see that. وَلِيَذَا بِاللَّهِ. Money is an idol. People worship it. Money. It's another idol. Everybody should memorize this dua. Oh Allah, save me and my children from worshipping idols. Wallahi. Because Allah told us to take Ibrahim as a model, right? Inna Ibrahim kana ummah. In fact, Allah told our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, thumma uhayna ilayka an ittabi' millata Ibrahim. Then we revealed to you, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you have to follow the way of Ibrahim. If he has to follow him, what about us? These du'as are very important. And today in the morning in tafsir of Surah Al-Imran, we discussed a very important du'a which also every Muslim should be making. Rabbana la tuzigh qulubana ba'da idh hadaytana. وَهَبْ لَنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَهَابِ. Every Muslim has to memorize that. You have to. Guidance is from Allah. You have to ask Allah to guide you every day. That is what we ask in the salah every day. And so if our minds and our hearts are not there, we are missing out. When you stand up and you say every day, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. You know what that means? It means guide us to the straight path. That is the greatest dua you can make as a Muslim. Guide me to the straight path. Guidance, there's two types of guidance. Guidance to the path to leave kufr to come to Islam. Guidance to the path. And then there's guidance on the path. On the path. You have to. Everybody has to. Umm Salama radiallahu anha, they came and asked her, what is the dua the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to make most at home? We know him outside, we want to know the dua he used to make most at home. She says what? Kana yukthiran yaqul, he used to say a lot, Allahumma ya muqallib al-qulub, thabbit qalbi ala deenik. Allahumma, oh Allah, ya muqallib al-qulub, the one who changes the hearts, thabbit qalbi, make my heart firm on my deen. On your deen, Afwan. These du'as, inshallah soon, I'm going to make a couple of videos for them. Short videos, so that you can play it and memorize it. And this is the month of du'a. So this is the danger of shirk. Ibrahim alayhi salam, who's a role model for all the Muslims, for all the people of Tawheed, he makes du'a for Allah to save him from shirk. What about me and you? Because shirk is dangerous. And then it is narrated in the hadith that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he said, أَخْوَفُ مَا أَخَافُ عَلَيْكُمْ الشِّرْكُ الْأَصْغَرُ فَسُئِلَ أَنْهُ فَقَالَ الرِّيَاءُ. He said sallallahu alayhi wasallam, what I fear most for you is the minor shirk. They asked, what is this minor shirk? He said to them, Ar-Riya. And there's a whole chapter on Riya. Riya is showing off. Ar-Riya is the opposite of Ikhlas. Ikhlas, sincerity. When you do anything you do, which is worship, giving a lecture, listening to a lecture, reading Quran, giving charity, praying, fasting, dua, every act of worship you do has to be sincerely for Allah alone. You don't want to please anybody except Allah. The opposite of that is riya. You want to please others and Allah. This is called riya, showing off. Showing off is a minor shirk. Why? What is the definition of shirk? You're setting up a partner with Allah. The pure ibadah of ikhlas, you're doing it only for who? Only for Allah. But if you're doing it, I'm doing it for Allah, but I also want people to say, MashaAllah, he's a good sheikh. MashaAllah, he's a good qari. MashaAllah, he gives a lot. It tells you what? You have set up a partner with Allah, right or wrong? You don't want just to please Allah. You want to please Allah and to please whoever is you want to please. That is what is called minor shirk. And there's a whole chapter on that we'll discuss with details. But it tells you the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, the thing I fear most for you the thing I fear most for you. Subhanallah. And some of the scholars, they call this shirk al-salihin. It is the shirk of the good Muslims. Because the good Muslims are not going to the idols to worship or not. No. But shaitan corrupts their intentions. You understand? And then he says, and this hadith is, by the way, it is authentic as reported by Sheikh al-Albani in his book, Silsilatu al-Sahiha, number 951. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, he narrated the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Man mata wa huwa yad'u min dunillahi niddan dakhala an-nar. Whoever dies while he is ascribing partners to Allah, he will enter the hellfire. He died upon shirk, he is going through the hellfire forever. Waliyadhan billah. And Muslim, Imam Muslim in his Sahih, he reports from Jabir radiallahu anhu that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, Man laqiya Allah la yushriku bihi shay'an dakhala al-jannah, wa man laqiyahu yushrik bihi shay'an dakhala al-nar. Whoever meets Allah on the day of judgment, not having associated any partners with Allah, he doesn't commit shirk, dakhala al-jannah, he shall enter paradise. Either directly, like we said, or even if he has other sins to be punished for, he will enter Jannah eventually. He'll enter paradise. But the one who goes on the day of judgment meeting his Lord, Allah, while he still died committing shirk, he never repented, he's going to the hellfire and he'll be therein forever. Allah says, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ وَالْمُشْرِكِينَ فِي نَارِ جَهَنَّمْ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا. Surely those who have disbelieved from the Christians and the Jews and the Mushrikeen, the other polytheists, they shall be in the hellfire forever. They shall be in the hellfire forever. And this tells us that La ilaha illallah is not just merely saying La ilaha illallah. You have to say La ilaha illallah and stay away from shirk. This is something many people, we have to understand. Islam, yes, you enter into Islam by saying La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. But that is not the only pillar of belief or aqidah, creed of Islam, no. There's a whole set of beliefs which go together. And that is the next chapter. الدعوة إلى شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله. The call to testify that there's nothing deserving of worship in truth except Allah. Our time is up though. We continue? One more chapter? It's a democratic country, so. Yes? Okay. He says, chapter number 5, the call to testify that there is none who deserves to be worshipped except Allah. Allah the Exalted, he said, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي وَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. This is Surah Yusuf. Say, O Muhammad, هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي, this is my way. Listen, all of those of us who say we try to follow and we love the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah is commanding him, say to them, this is my way. What is his way? أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ, I call, I invite people to Allah alone. عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ, and I do that upon clear knowledge, upon insight. أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي, I and whosoever follows me. The Prophet ﷺ is being commanded to tell the people, say to them, this is my way. What is his way? What is the Islam he came with? I call to Allah upon clear insight, basira. What does that mean? It has two meanings. And like we discussed today in the morning, Allah can say a statement in the Quran and it has two meanings and all of them are correct. This is my way, I call to Allah upon basira, insight. First meaning is when I do that calling, when I invite people, when I do the da'wah, I do it while having insight, while having knowledge. You only do da'wah when you have knowledge. That is the first meaning. Alright? So, ana wa man ittaba'ani, and that is I and whosoever follows me, he has to follow the same way. The second meaning, it means, say, this is my way, I call to Allah, ala basira, upon basira, meaning, I invite you to Allah, I call you to Allah, while I have clear insight, I have clear knowledge that this is the truth, I have no doubt. You understand? I call you, and I know what I'm calling you to. I have clear knowledge, clear insight. This is the truth. Ana wa man ittaba'ani, I and those who follow me. So if you want to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you have to call people to Allah. And you call them with knowledge, with wisdom. And when you call them, you yourself have to be firmly grounded in knowledge. You understand? And then to show what is this call. You see what the call is about? Ad'u ila Allah. I call to Allah. That is the da'wah of Ahl Sunnah. That is the da'wah of those who follow the Salaf in the right way. They don't call people to their masjid. They don't call people to their sheikh. They don't call people to their organization. This is what we call hizbiyya, partisanship. The call has to be for Allah. If this brother is going to Masjid X and they are calling people to Allah, they're calling to the clear sunnah, he doesn't have to come to this masjid for him to be guided. You understand? This is the problem we have today. Oh, he doesn't come to our masjid. What does that mean? Is he going somewhere which is wrong? If yes, then okay, that's a problem. As long as he follows the truth, he doesn't have to come to your masjid or to your specific sheikh, or let alone organizations. This is the disease which is affecting Muslims today, hizbiyya. We can't do this event unless our organization name has to be put there. La ilaha illallah. Are we calling people to Allah or to your organization? This is the disease we have. No, if you come with us, you don't go to another masjid. If, I'm saying again, if those other masjids of those other sheikhs, they have problems in their aqidah, they have problems in the way they practice Islam, then okay, you can warn against them. But if they are following the same thing, the truth, what is this, a bidding war? This is a disease you should be careful not to fall into. The real people who follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they call to Allah. They call to Allah. Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah, he used to say, I wish everybody will have the same knowledge I have without them coming back to say, I learned this from Shafi'i. Those were true Muslims. They don't need to be known. It doesn't have to be them. And then though to show what is the call of Islam, wa subhanallahi, and Allah is exalted. The meaning of subhanallah, listen carefully. Subhanallah means at-tanzih. When you say subhanallah, it means Allah is free from any imperfections. Allah is far away from any deficiencies. Allah is far removed from any bad qualities. That's the meaning of subhanallah. Anything which is not befitting Allah, we say subhanallah. Allah is far from that. Allah is perfect and exalted. That is why in the Quran it comes when they say, وَقَالُوا اتَّخَذَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَلَدْ. They say, Ar-Rahman, he has a child. Allah says what after? Subhana, he is far from that. It is not befitting from him. He is glorified and exalted from that. You understand? So next time when you say Subhanallah, it should come from your heart. You're glorifying your Lord by saying he is free from any imperfections. وَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ and Allah is exalted, is free from any imperfections. وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ and I am not from those who commit shirk. That is the call to Tawheed. You call to Allah upon clear knowledge, and it has to be upon Tawheed. Always the call is for Tawheed. And that is the way of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and those who follow him. So when you see these brothers today, when we just talked about, the truth is not by numbers. He has everybody, don't you listen to Sheikh Fulan? Everybody listens to him. Yet he is not upon this. This is the scale. If you want to know who's following the way of the Sunnah, who's not, look at his da'wah. Is his da'wah focused on Tawheed? Is his da'wah focused on teaching people Aqeedah? If not, leave that person. You don't need him. You don't need him. Because Allah says, قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي, say, this is my way, the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. أَدْعُوا إِلَى اللَّهِ, I call to Allah. عَلَى بَصِيرٍ, upon clear knowledge. أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي, I and those who follow me. So whoever, his call is not to Tawheed. Whoever looks down and plays down, teaching people Aqeedah, he is not part of this group. Or is he? He is not. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to teach people Tawheed from the first day to the last day. Aqeedah. What do you believe about Allah? What do you believe as a Muslim? What do you believe? And the Quran is, all of it is Aqeedah. So strange when someone can say he's doing tafsir of the Quran and then he's not talking about Aqeedah. But you can't blame them. Most of them, they haven't learned Aqeedah. They didn't never learn Aqeedah. While the Muslims, the Sahaba, the Tabi'un, the Tba'u Tabi'un, the great four Imams, Ahmad, Malik, Shafi, Abu Hanifa, all of them wrote on Aqeedah and taught people Aqeedah. Because Aqeedah is what distinguishes you from the non-Muslims, and what distinguishes Ahlul Sunnah, those who follow the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, from all the other sects. Next he says, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, لما بعث معاذا, when he sent out معاذ إلى يمن, to the country called Yemen, قال له, he said to him, إنك تأتي قوما من أهل الكتاب, O معاذ, you are going to a people who are people of the book. Yemen, at that time of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, there was a lot of Christians and Jews, and there was the Arabs who still worshipped idols. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he sent out Mu'adh ibn Jabal to go and call them to Islam. But when he sent him out, this hadith is reported by Muslim, by the way, and Bukhari, he said to him, O Mu'adh, you are going to people who are Christians and Jews predominantly. This is what we just talked about. Da'wah ala basira. You do da'wah with insight and wisdom. You have to know who you're speaking to. The da'wah you give to a Christian is not the same da'wah you give to a Jew. The da'wah you give to an atheist is not the same da'wah you give to a Hindu. Right or wrong? He told him, you are going to people of the book. فَلْتَكُنْ أَوَّلْ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ أو فَلْيَكُنْ أَوَّلْ مَا تَدْعُوهُمْ إِلَيْهِ. So let the first thing you are going to call them to, شَهَادَةُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهِ إِلَّا اللَّهِ, that they have to bear witness. There's only one true God who has to be worshipped, Allah. He didn't say to Mu'adh, go and tell them women have to wear hijab. They have to, but that's not the first priority. He didn't say, go and tell them they have to pray. They have to, but that's not the first priority. That is why he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَإِنْهُمْ أَجَابُوكَ لِذَلِكَ, if they accept the da'wah of Tawheed, to worship Allah alone, فَأَخْبِرْهُمْ, then tell them, أَنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ افْتَرَضَ عَلَيْهِمْ, that Allah has made obligatory on them خَمْسَ صَلَوَاتٍ, five prayers every night and every day. If they accept to enter Islam, then they can pray. What is the benefit of them praying and they're not Muslims? Tawheed, that is the da'wah of Ahl Sunnah, that is the da'wah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is the next hadith we just read. And we'll summarize. And then he says, both collectors, when they say both collectors, they mean Bukhari and Muslim. They have reported that Sahl ibn Sa'd, radiallahu anhu, he said, أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قال يوم خيبر. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم he said on the day of Khaybar. Khaybar, the famous place where the Jews used to live, the Jews of Medina in Khaybar. When the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was going to fight them because they broke the covenant, they had signed a peace treaty with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. They had signed a peace treaty with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. They will live in peace, coexist. But then when the polytheist Arabs, the mushrikun of the Arabs, they came to attack the Prophet ﷺ in the battle called the Battle of the Ditch, Ghazwatu Khandaq or Ahzab. These Jews, they broke the covenant, they betrayed the Prophet ﷺ, and they joined the others to fight against the Prophet ﷺ. So after the Prophet ﷺ, Allah defeated those people by sending a wind to them, Suratul Ahzab. Now they face them. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he said, "La'utiyana ar-raya." Tomorrow when you go to fight, I will give the banner, the flag. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the leader, but every army there has to be the leader of the army who's given the flag. And even in the army, you have different battalions, different groups. Every battalion can have his leader with the flag. And before, when they used to fight, the flag has to stay up. If the flag falls, then you are defeated. You understand? So he said, "La'utiyana ar-raya," tomorrow will give the banner. Ghadan, tomorrow, rajulan, a man. Yuhibbu Allah wa rasulah, a man who loves Allah and his messenger. Wa yuhibbuhu Allah wa rasulah, and Allah and his messenger love him. That is the greatest thing we can achieve as Muslims. That Allah loves you. His messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam loves you. Not only that, this is a testimony that this man is a true believer. He really loves Allah and his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yaftahu Allahu ala yadayhi, and Allah will give him victory tomorrow. He'll be the leader and will get victory. Subhanallah. He got the dunya, he's a great warrior who'll get victory, and the akhirah, he's someone Allah loves him. Ya Allah. The Sahaba, when they hear this kind of stuff, when they hear this, they are in another state. فَبَاتَ النَّاسِ يَدُوكُونَ لَيْلَتَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ يُعْتَاهَا. So the people, they all stayed awake. They couldn't sleep. Who is this special person? Nobody could sleep. فَلَمَّا أَصْبَحُوا غَدًا, when they woke up the next morning, غَدَوْا عَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ كُلُّهُمْ يَرْجُوا أَنْ يُعْتَاهَا. All of them flocked to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sitting close to him, hoping he'll be the person to be given that banner. They used to rush to do good. In fact, one narration says, Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, so I used to walk past the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam so that he can just call me. Then I would walk again, and then walk again. They used to respect him. They can't just come and say, oh, Messenger of Allah, give it to me. They had respect. He said, I would walk in front of him hoping he'll call me. Imagine Umar. Isn't he going to Jannah already? Huh? Yet they were rushing to do good. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said, أين علي بن أبي طالب رضي الله عنه? Where is Ali ibn Abi Talib? فقالوا, they said, هو يشتكي عينيه. He's complaining about his eyes. He couldn't even see. They traveled, he got some eye disease, he couldn't even see. فَأَرْسَلُوا إِلَيْهِ, so they sent for him. فَأُتِيَا بِهِ, they carried him to the Prophet ﷺ, they brought him. فَبَسَقَ فِي عَيْنَيْهِ, the Prophet ﷺ, he spit on his eyes. فَبَرَأَ كَأَنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ بِهِ وَجَعَ, he was cured as if he never suffered anything. The Prophet ﷺ, he is a blessing. Everything which comes from him is a blessing. Everything of the Prophet ﷺ has barakah, and only him. There's no other sheikh today who, if you touch his hand, you have barakah. You have to do this. La. That is not Islam. And whatever they parade around the world now, say, the hair of the Prophet ﷺ. How did you get that? But anyway, the Prophet ﷺ, he spit in his eyes and he was cured. فَعَتَاهُ الرَّايَ, gave him the banner. فَقَالَ, and he said, listen now. He said to him, "Unfud ala rislik, go calmly. Hatta tanzila bisahatihim, until you reach their boundaries. Thumma ad'uhu min al-Islam." Listen. And this is the intention of al-jihad in Islam. Jihad does not mean shedding blood. Jihad does not mean shedding blood. Islam is not a religion of shedding blood. They are going to fight. The first thing, first condition, when you go, call them to Islam. Before you fight them, you have to call them to Islam. وَأَخْبِرُوهُمْ بِمَا يَجِبُ عَلَيْهِمْ مِنْ حَقِّ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى, and inform them about the rights of Allah over them. فَوَاللَّهِ, because وَاللَّهِ, by Allah, لَأَنْ يَهْدِيَ اللَّهُ بِكَ رَجُلًا وَاحِدٍ, for Allah to guide through you one person, for Allah to bring to Islam one person through you, خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنْ حُمُرِ النَّعَمِ, it is better than the red camels. The red camels is the most prized, most expensive property of the Arabs back then. It's like saying today, it's for Allah to guide one person through you is better than having your own private jet. Da'wah to Tawheed. Da'wah to Tawheed. So if they go to fight, they have their weapons, everybody ready to fight, and they call them, come to Islam. They give them da'wah. If they accept, what do? They say, oh, we still have to kill them? La, a'udhu billah. These are the people with corrupted minds today. They don't tell, this is Islam. That is not Islam. If they accept, there's no fighting. You understand? But it shows you the importance of tawheed and calling people to tawheed. We'll stop here and continue tomorrow, insha'Allah. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, shadun la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.